Good morning, friends and family. We're here today to celebrate the life of Kim Pignatello. In that celebration of her life, we honor her life and the legacy that she leaves in her family, in you, Jill, and the impact that she made on those closest to her, her friends, her family. Kim was a friend. Kim was a mom. She was a leader. Kim was a servant. And most of all, Kim is a daughter of a heavenly Father who loves her very, very much. So as we reflect today, this is what I'm going to tell you. It's okay to smile. When you think about Kim and you think about memories, how good of a mom she was, how amazing of a friend that she was, a sister in Christ. So many of you knew her here at Crossroads. It's okay. Smile. Think about the memories. It's okay to cry. It's okay to tear up. Yes, today we celebrate that Kim isn't suffering in this broken world anymore, but we're also mourning the loss of someone dear and someone close. So it's okay. That void, that's going to be felt in your heart. Kim is going to be felt. She's going to be missed. So it's okay. Let those emotions be felt. The last thing I'm going to say, it's okay to laugh. It's okay. When you talk about a story or you share about some stubborn moment that Kim had, it's okay to laugh at a story. Many memories have been shared, these past few days. And today you'll reflect on Kim and her love for you. In the midst of all of this, remember the love that Jesus has for Kim and that Jesus has for you. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, in moments of loss, emotions can get stirred. Things can become foggy. Sometimes it's hard to see clearly. Lord, it's hard to see through the hurt and the pain and the loss of a dear mom, a friend, a sister in Christ. So I ask that you bring comfort today in the midst of the pain. Bring a peace in knowing that she loves you and she lived for you here on this earth. Kim worshiped you. Today we worship you. We trust you. We trust you in all things. In Jesus' name, amen. So today let's worship as we take a moment in song and sing together.
Surrounded by your glory, what will my
imagine. That brings peace to my heart. It makes me happy for Kim. She is in God's presence, in the presence of Jesus forever, forever and ever, for eternity. I'm going to now ask Miss Donna if you'll please come forward to read the scripture from Philippians 4, 6 through 7.
Good morning. A reading from Philippians. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will grant and guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus.
I'm now going to ask if Miss Dion will come forward. She's going to read the obituary and celebrate a little bit of who Kim is, what she's done here on earth.
Good morning. Kim M. Chilberg Pignatello, 56, of Manchester, passed away quietly on Wednesday, July 26, 2023, with her cherished daughter, Jill, at her side. Although she left us much too soon, Kim lived an extraordinary life. She was born in California on October 23rd, I'm not gonna say the year, to Frank and Leora Marino. Kim lived in California, Washington State, Idaho, Montana, Mexico, and all before the age of 16. Kim was also fluent in Spanish. Growing up with three brothers, Kim was a self-proclaimed tomboy, drawn to camping, hiking, football. She loved the challenge and had a strong sense of adventure. A talented teen, Kim went to the States for track, for cross country, for debate. And at 17, she climbed Mount Rainier with her adoptive dad, Skip Chilberg. Kim joined the Army after high school and served 4.5 years as a trilingual intelligence analyst and crypto analyst. She spent time in North Korea and saw combat in Panama during the operation that ousted General Noriega. In 1993, while a student at Washington State University, Kim's family ranch in Idaho was used for a 3-day concert in the school's what they call Greenstock series, drawing thousands of people. However, the event came to be renamed Mudstock because of the torrential rain that occurred and required the Red Cross to provide assistance to remove vehicles and people stuck in mud. Kim married Tony Pignatello and traveled with him to the U.S. Army bases in Amsterdam, California, and Texas, where they welcomed their daughter, Jillian. Moving to Connecticut in 2001, Kim worked for 18 years for the Veterans Administration in Newington as a vocational rehabilitation counselor and employment coordinator, finding jobs for hundreds of veterans. More recently, she worked for the Customs and Border Protection and Homeland Security in Warwick, Rhode Island. She is known for her warmth, her spirit, her baking skills. Kim made countless friends in each workplace and many co-workers that became family. A fervent Christian, Kim was a member of Crossroads Community Cathedral, working in the bookstore and starting a small group Bible study. Kim's faith enabled her to live with a positive outlook throughout her trials and to maintain her strength during the challenging days of her illness. Among those who cherish her memory, Kim leaves her beloved daughter, Jillian, a dear friend and Kim's greatest achievement, and she will tell you that. She leaves parents, Leora Chilberg of Spokane Valley, Washington, Frank Marino of Las Vegas, Nevada, Skip Chilberg and his wife Janelle of Kendrick, Idaho, brothers Mark Marino of Spokane Valley, Washington, Frank Chilberg of Longmont, Colorado, and Robert Chilberg of Spokane, Washington, ex-husband and friend Tony Pignatello, mother-in-law Sarah Pignatello, devoted sister-in-law Donna Winnock and her family, and special sisters Tara, Tina, Dion, Candy, Gina, all who are an important part of Kim's life and who will miss her dearly. We celebrate Kim's life and legacy here today. Thank you.
We're now going to have a moment of reflection, hear some stories from friends and family. So I'm going to ask if Pastor Marilyn will first come forward and share her heart.
Good morning. After hearing that, I don't know if there's a lot to be said because it really does explain who Kim is, but I'm going to do my best this morning. I really feel that we're here today celebrating a life who touched so many people and is going to have a huge ripple effect in years to come. And I know that Kim is seeing that in heaven as she's with God now. I have known Kim for at least 15, maybe 20 years. She immediately caught my attention while she was volunteering at the Crossroads bookstore. Something you need to know about volunteering at Crossroads. Crossroads is a huge family. It's not just a place to volunteer. When you start in a ministry, you inherit a family of friends, of co-volunteers. Your life intertwines with theirs, and there's this caring and this love that you share between each other that you just can't separate. So, as I got to know Kim on a more personal basis, I realized that Kim was no ordinary volunteer. Kim had a vision and had deep passion for her ministry. She made the Crossroads bookstore just a better place. I also learned that Kim's passion expanded beyond her ministry. It stemmed from her love of people and helping them, as was obvious with the occupations that she had. Kim always wanted to make the world a better place. She would see problems around her, and she would immediately try and to solve them the best she could, or at least come up with a plan to change things. Kim was devoted to whatever she put her mind to, but her deepest devotion was to God and her daughter, Jillian. Kim made many decisions in her life where she put her own needs last and the needs of her faith and her daughter first. She knew what was important in life, and she was happy with the good choices that she made. Kim spoke highly of everyone. She found it hard to be negative and would let herself go down rabbit holes, but quickly turn that around and see the positive. She would never let herself get into a dark place. She would always look up. Prayer was her best companion, and she had many prayers answered during her lifetime. Towards the end, I was very fortunate to have visited with her, with a very close friend of mine, Peggy Yost. We were able to spend time with her at her home. Kim was very much aware of her situation, and she was very aware of the outcome. There was one comment that Kim repeated several times during our visit, and she said, "Is this it? Is this all there is?" Peggy and I tried desperately to answer her and at the same trying to encourage her. But let's face it, an answer in that circumstance is difficult. I know now that her questions have been answered. that God has given her the only answers that she needs. He has completed her. Kim is healed and in the presence of an everlasting love and an eternal life. Since that visit, I've had time to reflect on Kim, on my visit with her, and those last few comments that she made. And so I'd like to try to just answer that today. Kim, this is it. Life here on earth is but momentary. It is a testing ground for everyone. Will we choose God or will we turn to the world? Will we choose to represent our Savior or will we choose to represent ourselves and think of only of ourselves? This is not our home, but a place to make our final decision. In saying all this, Kim, you chose well. You lived your life for God, and by doing so, you spread God's love to others. You put others first, and you represented your faith in God in everything you did. So your answer is yes. This is it. But Kim, you had a life well lived.
Now I'll ask Natalia to come forward to share.
I'm Nati. I'm here to honor to y'all Miss Kim, but to me, Mama. I'd like to begin with a poem. Tell them I was human. Tell them that I tried. Tell them that even on my darkest nights, I reach for the light. With the last shred of hope that my spirit could hold when I am gone, tell them how I loved like the surface of the sun. Tell them what I did when I was warm, breathing, and perfectly imperfect. Because of this poem, I'm going to share a story with you. She will call me her kiddo. She would call me her kiddo. Remind me, I know you're not a kiddo anymore, but you're my kiddo. And so I was. My favorite times being her kiddo was our quality times during our road trips. Most importantly, the one that set the foundation of our relationship. It was a beautiful accident on how it all began. On the way to catch the bus for the church camp, I get in an accident, literally on the way, and end up missing the bus for church camp. But because of Mama, I made it, and I tell you how. Mama drove me all the way to camp, and I don't know if y'all know this, but it's in New Hampshire. So, that wasn't just a little thing. She drove me all the way to New Hampshire for camp. It was beautiful. An act of an angel on earth. And that's who Mama was and always will be to me. Every trip and avenue I go through in life, I will carry you with me in my heart. I love you, Mama.
Thank you. Thank you, Nati, for sharing. I can't believe that bus left you. It's messed up. Listen, that might have been. I'm not going to lie. You made it. I'm now going to ask Gina Rivera to come forward to share on behalf of Skip Chilberg.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you for being here. I'm actually going to share on behalf of myself. Skip, I think, has a lot of words in his heart, and he has to hold them there today. But I'm going to share on behalf of my sisters. I just want to say that Kim gave everybody that she loved nicknames. You heard Mama. You heard Kiddo. I was Gigi. And so it's my honor today to say a few words on our behalf. I met Kim here at Crossroads. We were in a membership class, and I remember her saying to me, I just moved here and I don't have any friends. Do you want to be friends? And I said, yeah. And we were inseparable since then. I never had an older sister, so she was always the wise one that would give me advice when I needed advice. Because being the older sister, I always wanted to be a good role model for my younger sister. So Kim was always there to remind me who I was, and also to show me the way to God. I was such a young Christian when I met her, and I was so lost, and she always was our teacher. So these are the lessons that I learned from Kim Pignatello. Number one, she always taught us that we needed to study our Bible and memorize verses. Now, I don't know why Dion is laughing. So we met twice a month, Candy, Dion, myself. We were in a Bible study. And Kim, if you don't know her, had very high expectations. She would give us homework. We had to read, answer questions. Now, I don't know if you know what I do for a profession, but I'm an educator. So this is like a lot of extra work. But for Kim, we would do anything. And Kim had a very strong presence because whatever Kim said, you did and you knew. The other thing about Kim is she would always serve good food. So we showed up. So during many of these Bible studies, one of her goals was to get us to memorize verse because she told us it is the sword and it would be important that we hide God's word in our heart. And I said to her, I cannot memorize words. I'm a math person. I can only memorize my multiplication facts. So some of my teammates would show off their skills in Bible memorization. I'm not going to say names, Dion, but she's really good. But Kim never gave up on me. So one day she said, Gina, I have the Bible verse that I think you can master. I said, no way. There's none. I can't. I start and I can't end. She goes, I have it. Jesus wept. John 11:35. I was like, really, Kim? She goes, I knew you'd master. I felt so good about myself. So I just want to say thank you, Kim, for reminding me that it's important to God to always hide God's word in our hearts. Kim also was selfless. Whenever it came to me calling Kim, I would sometimes hear strange animals in the background. And I'm like, Kim, you don't have a pet. What is happening right now? And so if you don't know this about Kim, anybody who travels, she would take care of their dog or their cat because she was just that person. She would take care of animals. And then Jillian would get attached to the animal. And it would be so adorable to see them together. And so Kim's selflessness was apparent. Anybody had a baby shower, a wedding, she would make cupcakes. She would show up with food at work. She was just that person. She always brought something to bring hospitality to wherever she went. Finally, I think her greatest gift, and I think all of us were grateful, is that she knew when to check on people. She would call us, and sometimes I would let my phone go to voicemail because I just was having a hard day, and she would leave me the message. And her message was always like, Gigi, stop avoiding me, call me back.
And I think it was the way that God would speak to her and tell her, like, you need to check on them right now. And it didn't matter who it was her family, it was her daughter, it was us. She always knew. And then she would always say hi to Tito too, because she would never ever forget about our extended family. So I just want to thank her for always teaching us to always put others first. She always. And the person that she put first was God. And a close second was Jillian. Those were her two hearts. And we knew that, and there wasn't a day that we prayed that we didn't pray for those two things, that we got closer to God. And the only prayer that she ever asked for was pray for Jillian. I was like, Kim, do you want anything for yourself, please? And she would say no, because that's the person that she was. So I just wanted to honor her in that way and just say, I am so grateful that I met her and I'm a better person because of her. And I know that she's changed me in a good way forever. And so that's how I'm going to honor her, that this is a celebration of her beautiful life. It's a celebration of her spirit. It's a celebration of how she transforms people. Because you cannot be around Kim and not want to be a great person. So I just want to say thank you for giving me a few minutes to share some testimony. And I just want to wish the best to Jillian and just know that all of these people love your mom and we're all here for you too.
Thank you, Gina. Now I'm going to ask Tara to come forward, please, to share her heart.
For all of us here who knew and loved Kim, my name is Tara, and she was my best friend. It's a blessing that I'm able to pay tribute to her today, yet it is also heartbreaking to have to do so. As everyone here is probably aware, Kim spent several years of her life helping disabled veterans find employment. Almost 18 years ago now, I was one of the veterans Kim helped. In my case, I was especially fortunate because the job Kim helped me obtain was working beside her as a vocational rehabilitation counselor with the VA. Kim and I had only worked together for maybe a week or two when one day we were having lunch together. We were both laughing so hard we were crying. At one point, Kim looked at me and said, "I hope you know you're stuck with me as a friend forever now." Back then, we joked about how that meant someday we would both be in our 80s, racing each other down the halls in our wheelchairs and raising all kinds of ruckus in a VA nursing home. We were bound and determined to be one of the difficult veterans we were working with every day. I never imagined I would be standing here today trying to do the impossible, describing what a kind and wonderful person Kim was. But then most of you here already know that. After working with Kim for a while, I eventually moved from Connecticut. However, Kim and I always maintained our friendship throughout the years, despite the distance between us. Kim was always the friend I could count on. Anytime I was having a bad day, she was there to cheer me up. She was never one to judge. It didn't matter if I was right or wrong. She was just always on my side. I can't even begin to count the number of times I called her completely distressed, and Kim was always there to talk me down off of the ledge, so to speak. She was always there to listen, support, and encourage me. She was my rock. As I begin to search for the right words to describe Kim, it is nearly impossible to do. How do you do justice to a woman who was so simple, yet so unique? So full of others, so full of love for those she cared about, so full of laughter at times, it was nearly impossible to be in the same room and not laugh yourself. How do you do justice to a woman who endured so many tribulations in life, yet still managed to have a heart of gold? There are just no words that can do justice to the type of person Kim was, because she was truly one of a kind. Kim was always one who was readily there for others, but often struggled with allowing others to be there for her. When I first posed the idea of Kim, of us shaving our heads together so that she wouldn't have to watch her hair fall out, Kim was adamant that she was not going to allow me to do that for her. I listed out at least a dozen reasons why it was a good idea. I had searched it on Google. But she shot all of my ideas down. I finally told Kim that I had my own selfish reasons for wanting to do it. I said, if what the doctors say is true, and someday in the not too distant future, I'm going to lose my best friend, then I'm going to need a picture of us together with our bald heads to get me through the dark days that I will be forced to face. And with this, Kim agreed. The day we shaved our heads was an emotional day, but it's also one of my all-time favorite days I ever spent with Kim. It started out with a lot of tears of sorrow, but it ended with genuine tears of laughter. After the deed was done, we had so much fun that day, shopping, rubbing each other's head, and joking about how the hair on our legs was now longer than the hair on our heads. I remember looking over at Kim at one point that evening and thinking how beautiful she looked, with all of her hair gone and a huge smile on her face. For me, that day was a very special gift and a memory I will forever cherish. Throughout Kim's illness, I made several trips out here to visit her, wanting to steal and store away as many memories with her as possible. Kim and I were always close, but we got a lot closer during that time. It was during one of my trips out here that I noticed Kim stopped saying goodbye to me. Instead, as I was leaving, we would hug, say, I love you, and Kim would say, see you again. I believe Kim would want us to remember her and all the things that surround us. With the early morning dew on a clear, starry night, and the rustling of leaves and wind blowing through our hair, and winter's first snowfall and spring's early blooms, and the sweet song of a bird and the sound of the ocean's waves crashing on the shore. I will think of Kim with every beautiful sunrise and every captivating sunset. I will think of her and bask in the memories I have, while I also mourn the ones that will never be. Jillian, you were the light of your mom's life. She loved you immensely. There is no one who ever could or will take your mom's place. But I promise you, I will always try my best to be there for you, just as your mom always was for me throughout the years. Kim, it is so very hard for us who loved you to say goodbye. So instead, we will say see you again. We thank you for the laughs you shared and the joy you brought to our lives, for the love you brought into our hearts and the memories you left behind. Throughout her illness, Kim told me the hardest part for her was knowing how much pain and heartache her passing would bring to those of us who loved her. She didn't want any of us to suffer over her loss. Kim wouldn't have wanted our tears. So even though our hearts are broken, she would want us to remember her with love and with laughter. Rest in peace and love, Kim, until we meet again.
Now I'm going to ask Jill to come forward.
Most people are astonished by the relationship I had with my mother. They would always comment about how it wasn't normal for a mom and daughter to be best friends, or as close as we were, as we never really argued. They thought it was crazy that we would talk every single day, even though I moved 9 hours away at 18 years old. I even had people say I would never make it on my own without my mother because of how close we were. It was that type of stuff that went in one ear and out the other, because there was never anything in my life that was more important than my relationship with my mom. It's been just me and her most of my life. For 15 of the first 18 years of my life, it was just me and her. And when that's the case, you either go really tired of the other person, or it just fits. And that person becomes your safe place. My mom was my safe place. She was my best friend, my rock, my everything. Growing up with a single parent means I didn't necessarily have as much as a lot of my friends, but she never let me go without. There was times that she was working 4 jobs at one time just to make ends meet for us. And even if it meant she was paying for gas and pennies or going without dinner, she made sure that I was all right. I had everything I could ever want and then some because of her. My biggest fear in life was and still is disappointing her or letting her down, which she assured me time and time again I could never do. But it's always stayed in the back of my brain because I always want her to be proud of me. And since she passed, that's all I've heard from people, is how proud she was of me. When I found out my mom had cancer in 2021, I dropped out of college. I couldn't bear the pain of knowing that my mom was going to be going through the hardest battle of her life, and I let that consume me. I ended up moving home eventually, and during that time, my mom sat me down and said to me, "I won't be around to watch you have kids. I won't be around to watch you get married. But you graduating from college is within the timeline that the doctors gave me." And it was the week after that I re-enrolled at Liberty. Somehow she knew that my college graduation was going to be the last major event she was going to be able to attend. Mom's intuition, I guess. I don't really know. Walking across that stage with her in the audience was a moment that neither one of us would ever take for granted, knowing how hard it was for both of us to make it to that point. For me to be able to say, "Mama, I made it," was the most important thing I could ever do, not just for her, but in my life. Now, I know that there were times that she was mad at me or upset, but through it all, she showed unconditional love. "Do you know that I love you?" are the words that she would ask me almost every single day from the day I was born. She would text it to me, write it in cards. She even had it written on a pillow for me when I moved to college. At the time, I took those words for granted, but now I have those words with me forever. Literally, I actually have them tattooed on my ribs in her handwriting. So, they're with me forever. But that's who my mom was. She would love unconditionally and spread that love everywhere to everyone. It was hard not to love my mom, even if you only knew her for 5 minutes. She never judged anyone, embraced everyone with open arms, usually with food also. And my friends know that she treated everyone like her own kid. She would introduce herself as Kim, but everyone in my life has grown to just call her Mama. Even though I was her only child, she made everyone feel like they were part of the family. She was the only girl among 7 brothers, so I have no blood aunts, but the woman in her life I now call my aunts, because that's who she was. They became her family. She referred to all of them as sisters, never friends. She referred to my friends as her kiddos, never just my friends. My mom showed the world that blood doesn't make family, loyalty does, what it truly means. Mama, Mom, Ma, Lady, Woman, Ma'am. Those are just some of the names that I would call her. To not have the ability to use those names anymore, or have a home-cooked meal by her anymore, or to send her random Cody Co. updates anymore, is the hardest thing I ever have or ever will have to go through. She truly was an amazing woman. And Mama, I hope I continue to make you proud. I hope you know how much I love you, how much this world loves you, and how much we all miss you. But in the words of Phoebe Buffay, don't feel like you can't visit. Thank you.
Thank you all for sharing. We're now going to continue to reflect. Remember Kim through a media tribute.
Here I am, looking down on you from heaven. It's so peaceful, it's so free, like you pray. It is warm, it's so bright and so beautiful. All my fears and my pain have gone away. 'Cause here in heaven, oh, I miss you so. But I know we'll meet someday. But now, so bright here in heaven. I'm at peace, I'm happy and I'm free. And someday we will walk these clouds together. But first you must go and see the world for me. 'Cause here seize the day.
As I reflected on Kim and who she was here on this earth, her personality, her character traits, and you heard the theme. Many of you know Kim very deeply, but I'm going to hit on a few of those. Kim was bold. She would tell you what she thought. She kept it real. There was no sugarcoating it. Kim was who she was. Kim was strong. Jill, you gave her a run for her money just a few times. Kendra and I had a few meetings, just a few, meeting to discuss you, get a little wisdom and see what we could do to support. But Jill, I believe you got that strong, that same strength from your mama. Kim was a giver. She gave of her time and resources. She served faithfully, loving others. Kim was compassionate, even in her time of pain, in her time of battles. Here on earth, she worried about others. Deanna, I received a text from Kim after the passing of your mom in October. Pray for Dion. Jill, what a love she had for you. I mean, you hear the theme over and over. What a love she had for you. Her love and compassion just to know that you were okay. Kim had compassion towards people. And I know that Kim wants to know that you're okay today. She'll want to know that you're okay tomorrow. So lean into your family. Lean into your friends. Kim was a fighter. She had proven that over and over again in many facets, serving her country. In the recent years, she stayed steadfast as she fought, meaning she did not waver. She stayed true to who she was. She stayed faithful to Jesus through it all. There's a story that came to mind when I thought of Kim, and I know there's going to be a little conflicting parts in this story when you hear it, but there was this moment where Jesus was going. Someone had said, "Come, my daughter's sick. She needs to be healed." And in this moment, the word says a great crowd followed him and thronged about him. Another version says that they pressed around Jesus. A large crowd. And there was a woman who had a discharge of blood for 12 years and who had suffered much under many physicians and had spent all that she had and was no better, but rather grew worse. She had heard the reports about Jesus and came up behind him in the crowd and touched his garment. For she said, "If I touch even his garments, I will be made well." And immediately the flow of blood dried up, and she felt in her body that she was healed of her disease. When this verse came to my mind, when I was thinking about Kim and who she was, this word touched. I mean, picture this. A crowd around Jesus. It wasn't easy to touch in that moment, to touch Jesus. Doesn't life get in the way? Those moments when we know with everything in us, we know that we need Jesus. We need his strength. Moments like today, when the pressures of life, the hurts, the pains, whatever the crowd may be, it seems to be in the way. That word touched, you know what that means? In the Greek and Hebrew, it means to start a fire. To hold on, to seize, to grasp, to touch, the firm contact. It even goes as far as using the word harm with the association of the firmness. Kim had a crowd in her way these past years. She had every reason to doubt, to blame God, to fight him. Instead, Kim pressed through the crowd. She held on. Do you hear me? She held on to Jesus. She leaned into her faith. She trusted him. So maybe you're saying, "Well, wait a minute. Hold up. Kim wasn't healed. She reached out. She touched the garment. And this is a moment where if anyone's saying that in their mind, I disagree with you. There's a scripture in 2 Corinthians that says, so we are always confident, even though we know that as long as we live in these bodies, we are not home with the Lord. For we live by believing and not by seeing. We live by faith and not by sight. Yes, we are fully confident, and we would rather be away from these earthly bodies, for then we will be at home with the Lord. Kim, she knows what that means today. Better than anyone in this room, anyone listening online, Kim knows what it's like to be with the Lord. So whether you are here in the body or away from this body, our goal is to please Him. Revelation says it this way. I heard a loud shout from the throne saying, look, God's home is now among His people. He will live with them and they will be His people. God Himself will be with them. Hear this, Jill. Hear this. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or sorrow or crying or pain. All of these things are gone forever. Forever. And I sit here and that question comes, what about me? She's gone. I'm here. If I go back to that scripture in Corinthians, it makes it so clear. For while we are in this tent, we groan and are burdened because we do not wish to be unclothed, but be clothed instead with our heavenly dwelling so that what is mortal may be swallowed up by this life. But listen, now that the one who has fashioned us for this very purpose is God, who has given us the Spirit as a deposit guaranteeing what is to come. Kim had the Holy Spirit as a deposit for her time here on this earth. That was it. For a moment, all of us, we get a moment on this earth, a time. Use it wisely. Use it wisely. This verse 30, Jesus sees you. He sees you today. You who reach out. And today you can lean into Jesus. You can reach out. You can find comfort in Him. Or you can allow the crowd to overwhelm you. Whatever your crowd might be, the pride, the hurt, the unwillingness to seek His face because we know better. This is the last trait that I'm going to share about Kim that I believe overshadows all of those other traits of Kim. Kim is in love with Jesus. It's not past tense. Kim is in love with Jesus. You continue in this verse. And Jesus, perceiving in Himself that power had come out of Him, immediately turned about in the crowd and said, who touched my garment? And His disciples said to Him, you see the crowd pressing around you, and yet you say, who touched me? Who touched me? He saw Kim. He saw her in her worst moments and in her best moments. And I go as far as to say the Spirit in her is a deposit. He was with her in her best moments, and He was with her in her worst moments on this earth. Who touched me? And He looked around to see who had done it. But the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came in fear and trembling and fell down before Him and told Him the whole truth. And He said to her, daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your disease. Go in peace. Kim is at peace. Go in peace. I had the opportunity to be Jill's youth pastor and to partner with Kim in many ways, supporting and loving you, Jill. You had a mom who loved you so much. Not everyone gets that. Who cared very much, probably going through this, was more worried about you at times than her. Kendra and I got to see that firsthand. And Jill, you might have a lot, and by a lot, I mean you have a lot of those traits from your mom that she passed on to you. But the greatest legacy that you will carry out in living out this world is your faith in Jesus. Pressing through the crowd. The emotions, the pain, the opinions, the challenges of this world, and allow Jesus to be your Savior in every situation. That's your legacy. That's what you carry on. And I'm going to tell you this. She is proud of you and will always be proud of you. And that comment of people like, I don't even know if I'll make it without her. You're going to make it, Jill. She's in you. It would be a disservice to me and to my friend, to my sister Kim, if I didn't take this moment for you, to give you the opportunity to reach out, to touch Jesus today and asking him to be your Savior. And the step is just a prayer. It's an acknowledgement. That's that first step of saying, hey, I'll live for you. We all have crowds in our way. This world is broken, and in that, we are broken. We have mess. We have sin. And so this moment of just saying, Lord, I'll live for you. It's a moment of surrender. That's what it is. And so I'm going to ask if everyone will close your eyes, and you can pray this in your heart. I'm not going to ask you to do anything. You don't have to lift your hand. All you have to do, and you can whisper it if you want, but you can say a prayer like this. If today you're saying, I want that kind of faith. I want to reach out. You just say something like, Heavenly Father, thank you for sending Jesus to live on this world, to carry the weight of my sin, my shame, and then dying on the cross. Thank you that it didn't end there. You rose again, leaving the Holy Spirit as a deposit, as a friend. That's what Jesus said. The Holy Spirit is a friend. Today I accept you, Jesus, as my Savior. I will strive to live and press through the crowd to be with you. Holy Spirit, guide me every day, every minute, every second of my time here on this earth. In Jesus' name, amen. We're now going to continue in worship. Thank you. U.S. Customs and Border Protection Honor Guard will now present the American flag to the family. Family would like to share that in September, a full military honors burial service will be held at the State Veterans Cemetery at 317 Boland, Middletown, Connecticut, Saturday, September 9th at 11 a.m. You're all welcome. So if you have questions on where that's at, please connect with Pastor Janera. She can pass that information along to you. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. My encouragement to you, Jill, to family, lean on one another. That means not just tomorrow. It means the months ahead, the years ahead. Keep talking. Keep sharing memories. Don't bottle up. Don't lock up. All right? Thank you all for coming. Let's pray together. Amen. Heavenly Father, thank you. This place is not our home. This world is broken. Many are lost, and yet you give us another day to live for you. Another day to share the love of Jesus to those lost in the crowds. Give us the wisdom daily to live for you and the strength to stand in the midst of it all. In Jesus' name, amen.